Right. Good morning, students. So yesterday we have been learning about chlamydia. So as I told you that there are three important human infecting chlamydia, that is Chlamydia trachomatis, Chlamydia sittaci and Chlamydia pneumoniae. So today we shall learn about Chlamydia sittaci and the pneumoniae along with a short topic on mycoplasma. And finally we'll cover up with L forms and a short note, very, very important question. That is non-specific urethritis. So that is the journey today. So these are the beautiful parasites which are responsible for causing this infection that is known as psittacosis. Right. So parrot, the Greek word for the parrots is psittacos. And this was first used by Morange. And this infection is mainly caused by the parakeets and the parrots, which we call them as cetacean birds. So this causes infection of birds as well as mammals. And psittacosis, it's a disease of parrots that is transmitted to man. And there is a similar disease, which we call it as ornithosis, that is transmitted by non-cetacean birds. That is, apart from your parrots and parakeets, other birds like pigeons, chickens, ducks, geese and turkey are responsible for this disease known as ornithosis. Right. So the infection in birds is usually subclinical. So to define psittacosis, this is the human Chlamydia sittaci disease is acquired from contact with cetacean birds known as parrots and parakeets. So in this group of parrots and parakeets, we have parrots, cockatoos, we have lovebirds, macaws, and also we have a New Zealand parrot, which we call it as Strigopidae, which are responsible for transmission of this infection known as psittacosis. So ornithosis, to define it, human Chlamydia sittaci disease that is acquired from contact with non-cetacean birds, that is pigeon, chickens, ducks, geese and turkey, we call it as ornithosis. As I told you, these are the cetacean birds, that is cockatoos, these are the lovebirds, this is macaw, that is, this is Strigopidae, which is responsible for causation of your psittacosis infection. As I told you, this disease is subclinical in birds, and they are usually the carriers. So how is this disease precipitated? So disease may be precipitated by caging or by overcrowding. And it is manifested as diarrhea, and it is mucopurulent respiratory discharge and emaciation. What do you understand by emaciation? It is a stage of being excessively thin or wasted. So the birds have diarrhea, they have mucopurulent respiratory discharge along with their wasting. That is, the body will be so thin. That is, it is excessively wasted. So chlamydia are shed in the droppings as well as in the nasal discharge, and aerosols are liberated by these birds. So humans, the infection is occupational because it is mainly seen in poultry workers. It is seen in pigeon farmers, pet shop owners, bird fanciers, or sometimes it is also seen in veterinarians. So the agent is present in nasal secretion and excretal tissues and also in feathers, as I told you. And the human infection is by inhalation and rarely by parrot bird bites. So remember one point, that is, consumption of these poultry products will never lead to infection. So infection is mainly by inhalation, and until and unless parrot bites you or you bite the parrot, the infection won't come to you. So case to case transmission, it is seen in humans, and the strains from parrots and turkey are more virulent than those of other avian sources, as I told you. So as I told you that this psittacosis may be transmitted both by parrots as well as other birds. So the strain of parrots and turkey are mostly virulent when compared to your other avian sources. Now coming to the incubation period, it is roughly near 10 days. And the incubation period varies from around 7 to 14 days. So the infection varies from mild influenza-like symptoms to fatal pneumonia. So usually the psittacosis is a septicemic condition, which may lead to meningoencephalitis and endocarditis, along with pericarditis, arthritis, or typhoid-like syndromes. What is the pathogenesis or pathology of this infection is? We usually see the patchy inflammation of the lungs consolidated areas, which are sharply demarcated like this. So the minor changes occur in the large bronchioles and also bronchi. The other organs that are usually infected are liver, spleen, heart, and kidney, and they are usually enlarged and congested. So how do you, these are the inclusion bodies of your Chlamydia cittasi. So what is the laboratory diagnosis you do is, Chlamydia can be isolated from blood. So during the early stages of the disease, it can be isolated from the blood. The infected cells, like your alveolar macrophages from patients, mouse brain, or yolk sac and cell cultures show the inclusion bodies. When I was telling you the laboratory diagnosis yesterday, I told you that we usually collect blood and sputum, where we try to isolate this Chlamydia cittasi in the cultures, that is in your cell cultures. And embryonated egg yolk inoculation is also useful for observation of your inclusion bodies. Usually it is very much hazardous to work with Chlamydia cittasi cultures because the aerosol spread is very much common here. So this is isolated from blood and sputum or even from lung tissue using the tissue cultures or embryonated egg. And yesterday I told you that we can inoculate this Chlamydia cittasi into mice by various routes, that is intraperitoneal, intracerebral, intranasal, and subcutaneous routes also, in which the mice is the experimental animal where we can isolate Chlamydia cittasi. So the infected cells show inclusion bodies, that is Levinthal Cole Lilly bodies. We also call them as LCL bodies. So Levinthal Cole Lilly bodies. Yesterday when I was telling you Chlamydia trachomatis, Lugol's iodine is used to stain the inclusion bodies of Chlamydia trachomatis, which we call them as HP bodies, that is Halbester Provisec bodies, that is HP bodies. Whereas in Chlamydia cittasi, we call it as Levinthal Cole Lilly, that is LCL inclusion bodies. So these usually come as the bits in your multiple choice questions or in your NEET questions also. They come as inclusion body of Chlamydia cittasi. So remember this word, that is LCL bodies. So usually the inclusion bodies, they differ from Chlamydia trachomatis by being more diffuse, they are irregular, and they are not stained by iodine, and they are not inhibited by sulfasinide and cycloserine. So isolation should be attempted in the laboratories with special containment, as laboratory infection is a serious hazard in isolation of Chlamydia cittasi. Various serological tests are done, that is group specific antigens, we do complement fixation testing, and for type specific micro immunofluorescence is done. So the detection of antibodies, this is the immunofluorescence technique. So how do we detect the antigen? That is direct fluorescent antibody staining. We do immunoassay, and molecular diagnosis is by PCR. So this is about your Chlamydia cittasi. To brief out the ornithosis, I told you that other than parasites, the parrots and parakeets, we have the other birds which are responsible for transmission of this infection. We call it as ornithosis. So pigeons, chickens, these are the ducks. This is the geese and turkey. So turkey and parrots have more virulent stains when compared to all other birds, what we have learned today. The next important human infecting Chlamydia is Chlamydia pneumoniae. Grosten and colleagues have isolated the Chlamydia strain from the respiratory disease in the adult in Twain, and this is called as Chlamydia cittasi strain TWAR. and it possesses the group specific antigen that is common with both Chlamydia cetacea and Chlamydia trachomatis. DNA hybridization restriction endonucleases analysis usually showed its differentiation only with species specific antigen. The group specific antigen is common with cetacea as well as Chlamydia trachomatis, whereas only species specific antigen is variant. So when I was telling you, when I was tabulating you the serovars of this whole Chlamydia, in Chlamydia trachomatis I have mentioned that A, B, BA, C are the serovars which are responsible for transmission of your trachoma. And D2K serovars are responsible for your conjunctivitis and genital chlamydiasis. And finally, L1, L2 and L3 were responsible for transmission of lymphogranuloma venereum. And the Chlamydia cetacea, I told you that there are many serovars. And for Chlamydia pneumoniae, I told you that it is only one serospecific antigen that is available. So DNA hybridization and restriction endonucleases, they showed the difference only with species-specific antigen. The group-specific antigen, it is common with both Chlamydia cetacea as well as Chlamydia trachomatis. So what happens here? The transmission is mainly from human to human. It usually does not grow in cell cultures. It is very poor to grow in cell cultures. So commonly the respiratory disease is seen in older children and adults worldwide. So the inclusion here is, it is round, dense, glycogen negative inclusions are seen for Chlamydia pneumoniae. So this is the Chlamydia pneumoniae. So this is, that is HEP2 cells where the growth of Chlamydia pneumoniae is observed like this. So what is the clinical spectrum of this infection is? It is manifested with acute pharyngitis, sinusitis, bronchitis and pneumonitis. So the onset is by asthma. The incubation period of this infection is around 1 to 3 weeks. So the primary infection occurs in young children. And reinfection is most common. So primary infection is more severe and prolonged than reinfections here. There is one more important one to remember, that is atypical pneumonia. This is the primary recognized illness that is caused by Chlamydia pneumoniae. There is an association of Chlamydia pneumoniae with atherosclerotic disease. That is Chlamydia pneumoniae with atherosclerosis and its effect like coronary, carotid and cerebral arteries is being found. So there is a serological evidence of Chlamydia pneumoniae infection in atherosclerotic disease of coronary, carotid and cerebral arteries. So Chlamydia pneumoniae has been identified in atherosclerotic plaque by electron microscopy, DNA hybridization and immunocytochemistry. So antigen detection is by enzyme immunoassay, as I told you. And direct immunofluorescence or molecular methods can be employed in order to diagnose this particular infection that we'll learn in the next slide. So this organism has been recovered in cultures from erythromatous plague that is usually isolated from your arteries. So laboratory diagnosis, as mentioned earlier, that is fluorescent antibody technique is the most sensitive method. Enzyme immunoassay and usually the stains are not effective in order to identify your antigens. So the swabs are collected from the pharynx and they're transported in the medium at 4 degrees centigrade and they are cultivated in the tissue cell lines, that is HL cells and HEP2. So the inclusion bodies are demonstrable by fluorescent antibody staining. So complement fixation test, ELISA or micro immunofluorescence can be used in group reacting. And does not differentiate Chlamydia pneumoniae infection from others. So what is the treatment we usually give is clarithromycin or azithromycin is the drug of choice. So to summarize the whole characteristics of Chlamydia and the three species what we have learned from yesterday till today, that is the three important species causing human infection, that is Chlamydia trachomatis, Chlamydia pneumoniae and Chlamydia sitaceae. So the inclusion morphology of Chlamydia trachomatis is round and vacular, whereas in pneumonia it is round and dense. In sitaceae it is large, variable in shape, and it is dense. So the glycogen inclusions are common or present in Chlamydia trachomatis, whereas they are not seen in Chlamydia pneumoniae and Chlamydia sitaceae. So the elementary body morphology is round. It is pear shaped in Chlamydia pneumoniae, and in Chlamydia sitaceae also it is round. So almost all the three species have elementary morphology as round, but only in pneumoniae sometimes pear shape can be observed. So the susceptibility to sulfonamides, it is seen mainly in Chlamydia trachomatis, whereas it is not seen in Chlamydia pneumoniae and Chlamydia sitaceae. So DNA homology to Chlamydia pneumoniae, it's less than 10, it's 100%, and here it is also less than 10%. So plasmids you see in Chlamydia trachomatis, whereas not seen in Chlamydia pneumoniae and Chlamydia sitaceae. Serowarts are 15, that is A, B, B, A, C, D to K, L1, L2, L3. On a whole, you have 15 here. Chlamydia pneumoniae, you have only 1. Chlamydia sitaceae, that is more than or equal to 4 serovarieties are seen in sitaceae. Natural host. For trachomatis and pneumonia, it's human, and sitaceae, as it is a bird transmitted or avian infection, the sitaceae have birds here as the natural host. The mode of infection, in trachomatis we see person-to-person transmission, and even mother-to-infant transmission is seen, because yesterday when I was telling you about infant pneumonia, it is transmitted when it is passing through the birth canal. So just remember that person-to-person transmission or mother-to-infant transmission is seen in Chlamydia trachomatis. Chlamydia pneumoniae, airborne person-to-person transmission. And sitaceae is also airborne, but bird excreta to humans, as it is responsible for droppings, that is either the respiratory secretions or the droppings of the bird may lead infection to humans by the mode of inhalation. The major diseases of Chlamydia trachomatis, trachoma, sexually transmitted diseases, what we have learned yesterday, that is genital chlamydiasis. We see infant pneumonia and lymphogranuloma venereum, which has most clinical significance for trachomatis. In pneumonia, we see pneumonia, bronchitis, pharyngitis, as well as sinusitis that is caused by Chlamydia pneumoniae. Chlamydia sitaceae, that is psittacosis, pneumonia, fever of unexplained origin are the most common diseases that are associated with Chlamydia sitaceae. I hope this summarizes the whole Chlamydia what you have learned yesterday. With this, we finish off the Chlamydia. The next important topic we're going to learn is about mycoplasma. And this will be followed by covering certain miscellaneous human infecting bacteria in the next coming classes. So mycoplasma is also an important short notes that come in your examinations. So mycoplasma, what do you understand by mycoplasma? Myco or mycus means fungus, or plasma is formed. So how do you understand this mycoplasma is? So these are the smallest free living microorganisms that usually grow in the cell-free media. So yes, the previous class what we have learned about Chlamydia, Rickettsia and all, they are the obligate ones which strictly require your living organism for their growth. Whereas mycoplasma can grow as a free living organism and lives as a grows in cell-free media. So this is the smallest free living microorganism that is grown in cell-free media. Remember this. So what are the usual species that cause human infections? So mycoplasma pneumoniae is responsible for causation of pneumonia in individuals. Ureoplasma urolyticum, that is for non-gonococcal urethritis, or we also call it as non-specific urethritis, which we'll learn in a short time now. Mycoplasma hominis, mycoplasma genitalium, is responsible for genital tract infections. So remember, mycoplasma comes as a short notes. When that comes, these points are important to be written. That is, they are the smallest living microorganisms that grow in cell-free media, and the common infections that is caused by these species of mycoplasma are: pneumonia is caused by Mycoplasma pneumoniae, non-specific urethritis caused by Ureoplasma urolyticum, genital infections are caused by Mycoplasma hominis and Mycoplasma genitalium. Now, coming to Mycoplasma, so these are the group of bacteria that are usually devoid of cell walls. So they are highly pleomorphic. As there is no distinct cell wall present, there is one more characteristic you should remember. That is, the antibiotics that act on the cell wall don't act here. So all Mycoplasma are resistant to penicillins. So remember, as these organisms lack cell wall, these are highly resistant to penicillin and they are highly pleomorphic. Pleo is many, morphic is morphological forms, so it appears in many morphological forms. So they are bound by a trilayer ramnar layer, which is contained with the sterols. So this membrane is contained with sterols. So because of their plasticity, they can pass through bacterial filters and have been mistaken as viruses as of that in chlamydia. Chlamydia also, I told you that they have the capacity of filterability through the bacterial filters. That is the reason they were confused or mistaken as viruses. The same story repeats here for Mycoplasma also. Because they do not lack a specific cell wall, they can pass through the bacterial filters, which were mistaken as viruses. As I told you, myco is fungus and plasma is, it has plasticity to shape, or it appears in many forms. So that is the meaning of your Mycoplasma. Coming to the morphology, they pass through the filters of around 450 nanometers pore size. Usually the bacterial filters what we take is about 450 nanometers pore size. So they have the capacity to pass through the bacterial filters. So they usually occurs as granules or filaments of various sizes, and they may be appearing as coccoids, balloons, disc or ring shape or star shaped forms. So the filaments are slender of varying length, and they also show true branching. I'll show you in the next slide. So the first slide, when I have put the Mycoplasma heading, I have shown you various morphologies. That is nothing but, that is not the design actually. It is the morphological forms of your Mycoplasma that exists. So the multiplication is by binary fission here, and they do not present possess spores or flagella or fimbriae, and sometimes they exhibit your gliding motility. They are gram negative and they are better stained by GIMSA staining. So this is the Mycoplasma. This is your branching that is seen, that is appearing in many morphological forms. That is, there is no specific or fixed shape that is present for Mycoplasma. So the culture, I told you that they can be grown in cell-free media. So your tissue cultures, your egg and your animals are not required for cultivation. A simple media that we use in our laboratories is enough to cultivate this. So they can be cultivated both in solid and liquid media. So they are the facultative anaerobes, but better grown aerobically. The growth appears at around 20 to 40 to 41 degrees centigrade. And usually here, the parasitic species of Mycoplasma, they grow better at 35 to 37 degrees centigrade, which is understood that that is the human body temperature where the parasite loves to grow. So usually this organism is saprophytic at low temperatures. And the media what we use here is usually enriched with 20% horse serum and yeast extract, and also which act as the source of cholesterol and lipids. Penicillin and thallium acetate are added as selective agents for this. And colonies appear usually after 2 to 6 days of incubation that measure around 10 to 600 micrometers in their size. So colonies that are produced are usually biphasic. Why am I calling this as biphasic? Is bi is two, phasic is it appears as two phases. So the typical appearance of this Mycoplasma colonies, we call them as fried egg appearance. Okay, if you have ever eaten an omelette, you'll know what is fried egg. So fried egg appearance is the typical characteristic of this colonies known as Mycoplasma. So what does it contain? This consists of a central opaque granular area that is extending into the depth of the medium surrounded by translucent peripheral zone. I'll show you the image of this fried egg appearance in the next slide. Just to remember, fried egg appearance is nothing but it consists of a central opaque granular area extending into the depth of the medium that is surrounded by a translucent peripheral zone. And these colonies can be studied by Dyens method. What do you understand by Dyens method is, when a colony is growing on the surface of the medium, when you cut a block of this agar containing the colony and you place it on a cover, on a glass slide, and cover it with alcoholic solution of methylene blue and azure, then you can clearly observe the colony, that is your fried egg appearance of the colony, which you call it as Dyens method. So remember, the fried egg appearance is nothing but the colonies that appear as biphasic, which consists of central opaque and the peripheral translucent zones, which can be studied by Dyens method by using your alcoholic methylene blue and azure that I will show you in the next slide. So in the liquid medium, there's no turbidity is observed, and pleomorphic forms are usually seen in your liquid. So this is your fried egg appearance. So to clearly see this, so the central biphasic portion is your granular area surrounded by the translucent one. So when you cut open, when you dig it like this, so there is a dig, fried egg appearance is nothing but your sectioned colony shows your central zone that is embedded in the agar, which is granular and opaque, and peripheral zones on the agar surface is your translucent. That is the reason you call it as fried egg appearance. So when you put methylene blue and azure, this whole portion is looking darker in color, whereas here it is less. So this is about your Dyens method to observe and the fried egg colony, that is the cut section. Now coming to the biochemical reactions and resistance of the organism, these organisms are usually chemoorganotrophs. So the metabolism is usually by fermentation. Glucose and arginine are used as the major sources of energy by these organisms. Urea is usually not hydrolyzed, except one species of mycoplasma that is known as Ureoplasma urolyticum, which has the capacity to hydrolyze urea. So urease positive mycoplasma, remember the name itself suggests it is Ureoplasma urolyticum. So all other species of your mycoplasma are urease negative. So the resistance of this bacteria is, they generally resemble the non-sporing bacteria. They're resistant to penicillins and cephalosporins and lysozymes, because the reason I told you that they are the cell wall deficient forms, and they are sensitive to tetracyclines. The growth is usually inhibited when we use gold salts, so which is not mentioned here, right? So next, coming to the classification, just remember this one. This is important to understand the further of your mycoplasma. So this mycoplasma belongs to the class molecules, and they belong to the order mycoplasmatales. The families, we have four important families to study. That is Mycoplasmatacea, that is Ecoliplasmatacea, Pyroplasmatacea, and Aneroplasmatacea. That is, there are four important species of mycoplasma, that is families. Mycoplasmatacea, the name here, you can remember that it requires cholesterols and sterols as essential growth factors. So here in Mycoplasmatacea, we have two important species of clinical importance, that is mycoplasma that is causing non-specific urethritis, mycoplasma pneumoniae causing pneumonia-like symptoms, ureoplasma urolyticum causing again non-specific urethritis. So mycoplasma utilizes glucose and arginine for its growth, whereas ureoplasma has a characteristic to hydrolyze urea. So remember, class molecules, order mycoplasmatales. The family of Mycoplasmatacea, it requires cholesterol and other sterols as essential growth factors. Two important species here is Mycoplasma and Ureoplasma. Mycoplasma utilizes glucose and arginine, whereas Ureoplasma has the capacity to hydrolyze urea. Next family is Ecoliplasmataceae. Ecoliplasmataceae are the saprophytic mycoplasmas, and they do not require any sterols as growth factors. So Mycoplasmataceae requires cholesterol as well as your sterols as essential growth factors. E. coli, that is A, is without cholesterol. So they do not require sterols for their growth factors. Next family is Spiroplasmataceae. So this Spiroplasmataceae are usually the parasites of arthropods and plants. And this sterol dependent, and they are helical in shape. Spiro is something which is, it is coiled or it is a curve. So spirally or spirochete is something which shows that it is spiral or curved. So Spiroplasmataceae is a type, is a family that belongs to your molecules or mycoplasmatales, which usually infects your arthropods and plants. So they are also sterol dependent, but they are helical in shape. The genus is Spiroplasma. The next one, last family, is your Aneroplasmataceae. The genus is Aneroplasma. So these are the strict anaerobes, and usually they are found in the rumen of cattle and sheep. So classification, to remember again, to just summarize, they belong to the class molecules and the order Mycoplasmatales. And the family, we have Mycoplasmataceae, Aneroplasmataceae, Spiroplasmataceae, and Ecoliplasmataceae. So Mycoplasmataceae requires cholesterol and sterols. Ecoliplasmataceae, they do not require sterols. Spiroplasmataceae, they are the parasites of arthropods and plants, and they are sterol dependent and helical in shape. Aneroplasmataceae, anaerobic, that is, they are strict anaerobes, and they are found usually in the rumens of cattle and sheep. So this is about a brief note on the classification of your mycoplasma. Next, coming to the pathogenicity of this disease. So generally, they produce the surface infections, that is, adhering usually to the mucosa of respiratory, gastrointestinal, or genitourinary tracts. There are mainly two types of infection, that is Mycoplasma pneumoniae and genital infections, that are most commonly associated with your mycoplasma. First, coming to Mycoplasma pneumoniae. So the disease is tracheobronchitis, which is manifested by acute pharyngitis, and it is mostly uncommon. That is, 1/3 of the patients develop pneumonia, and usually it is a self-limiting disease. The onset is usually gradual with fever, malaise, headache, and sore throat. The incubation period, it's 1 to 3 weeks. So usually the cough that is produced is blood-tinged, and as discussed, it is a self-limiting disease. So the etiological evidence is, like, we have patchy involved, that is one of the lower lobe starting at the hilum and fanning out to the periphery is usually seen as the radiological evidence. So patchy involving of one of the lower lobes starting at the hilum and fanning out to the periphery. Fanning out and that is thinning out to the periphery. So the recovery occurs within 1 to 2 weeks, and the transmission is by droplets of nasopharyngeal secretion. So mycoplasma remain in throat for around 2 or more months after the recovery from the disease. So this is the chest X-ray, that is radiological evidence, that is consolidation, patchy involvement of the one of the lower lung, that is starting at the hilum and fanning out to the periphery. So this is the chest X-ray of the patient who is suffering from Mycoplasma pneumoniae. The genital infections we'll learn later, just a bit later. That is lab. Now coming to the laboratory diagnosis, the specimen that is used for isolation is throat swabs and respiratory secretions. And remember one point: immediately when we collect this throat swab and respiratory secretions, they are inoculated into the transport media. Why? Because to prevent the drying and the bacterial overgrowth by the other species. Why? Because your throat and your respiratory secretions are heavily loaded with other microorganisms, that is your normal commensals. In order to prevent their overgrowth and also the drying of your droppings, we immediately transfer it into the transport media. Transport media, you know, the media that is useful for the transportation of the clinical specimens. So what is the medium that we use here is, we call it as PPLO broth. So the transport medium of mycoplasma medium, this contains usually glucose and phenol red, which we call it as PPLO broth. And containing tryptic soy broth with bovine serum albumin. So transport medium of mycoplasma, it contains tryptic soy broth with bovine serum albumin. You just remember that word, tryptic soy broth with bovine serum albumin is the transport media for transportation of throat swab and respiratory secretions. So how do you grow this? That is, culture is usually made on the complex media, that is biphasic rich enriched media with growth stimulating substances like yeast and horse serum are used. Why am I telling you these two is, they require cholesterol and sterols for their growth, as I told you in the classification itself. So the medium that we are going to use for cultivating your mycoplasma should contain yeast and horse serum, which act as immense sources of your cholesterol and other sterols. So penicillin and thallium are usually used in order to inhibit the growth of other bacteria. And the colonies, they grow very slowly. That is the reason I told you that they appear after 1 to 3 weeks. Colonies, as discussed earlier, they have fried egg appearance. And these colonies cause hemolysis in guinea pig RBC. So remember this point, that is fried egg appearance on general solid media, whereas in here in guinea pig RBC cells media, it produces hemolysis. So how is growth indicated? So growth is usually indicated by acid production in the media, and growth is keened by tetrazoleum reduction test, in which the mycoplasma colonies reduce the colorless tetrazoleum to red color formosome. So this is a 2 marks question again, tetrazoleum reduction test, or it may even be asked as a multiple choice question or in your bits. So tetrazoleum reduction test is, mycoplasma colonies, they reduce the colorless tetrazoleum to red color formosome. So this is the cultural technique. Next, coming to the molecular methods, we have PCR. Then other serological tests are, we have specific tests and non-specific tests. So specific tests by immunofluorescence, hemagglutination, complement fixation and indirect hemagglutination. And non-specific tests, remember, that is Streptococcus MG. That is, this MG is nothing but it is a group of Streptococcus, that is Streptococcus salivarius, which is the commonest species that is present in the mouth. So they belong to Milleri group. That is the reason why MG is used here. So Streptococcus MG, that is Milleri group Streptococcus, are taken, and they are mixed in serial dilutions with patient serum. That is, heat kill suspension of Streptococcus is mixed with serially diluted patient's serum, and we observe for agglutination after overnight incubation. So what happens here is, the titer 1 in 20 or above is considered significant. Streptococcus MG test is nothing but heat kill suspension of Streptococcus MG is mixed with serially diluted patient's serum, where after incubation for overnight, agglutination is observed. So the titer 1 in 20 or above is considered significant, which is the non-specific test to diagnose your mycoplasma. Next, coming to cold agglutination test. So this is useful for the cases with primary atypical pneumonia, and macroglobulin antibodies usually agglutinate human group O cells at lower temperature. So serial dilutions of unrefrigerated patient serum is mixed with equal volumes of 0.2% washed human O group erythrocytes. So the clumping is observed after leaving at 4 degrees centigrade for overnight. So the clumping usually dissociates at 37 degrees centigrade, and a titer of 1 in 32 is suggestive, but the demonstration of raised titer in paired serum is more reliable. So this is just to remember as it is. That is the reason why I have read it out. So what is cold agglutination test? This is done for cases with primary atypical pneumonia. So here the antibodies agglutinate human group O cells at lower temperature. So serial dilutions of your unrefrigerated patient serum is mixed with equal volumes of 0.2% washed human O group erythrocytes. That is RBC of your O blood group individuals is taken and equal volumes is added with the patient's serum. Then clumping is observed after leaving at 4 degrees centigrade. So clumping usually dissociates at 37. So a titer of 1 in 32 is suggestive, but the rise in titer should be there in order to say that the test is positive. So this is about the cold agglutination test. So remember, this also comes as a 2-mark question. Next, coming to the genital infections. Genital infections is caused by Mycoplasma hominis and Urea plasma, urea lytica. So the transmission is by sexual contact, and this infection is isolated from, that is, Mycoplasma is usually isolated from the urogenital tract of human beings, and they form the tiny colonies, which we call them as T strains. They cause urethritis, proctitis, balanophthisis, Ritter's syndrome, acute salpingitis, PID, cervicitis, and vaginitis. Infertility, abortion, and postpartum fever are the most commonest things. So yesterday I was telling you about Ritter's syndrome. Ritter's syndrome is also common in genital infections. When I was telling you that it is a triad of infection, that is, Ritter's syndrome is a triad that consists of conjunctivitis, urethritis, and infective arthritis. That is, you can easily remember that the patient who has Ritter's syndrome can't pee, can't see, can't climb a tree. That means due to conjunctivitis, he can't see. Due to urethritis, he can't pee. Because he has arthritis, he can't climb a tree. So just to remember that Ritter's syndrome is a triad of infection. That is, a patient can't see, can't pee, or can't climb a tree because of the triad, that is urethritis, conjunctivitis, and arthritis. Right. So the treatment is by tetracycline and doxycycline. So the next most important is L forms of bacteria. So bacteria, they either spontaneously or due to the induction or by certain substances like penicillin, lose a part of their cell wall or all of their cell wall, and they develop into L forms. Either spontaneously or due to the action of certain chemicals like or certain components or substances like penicillin, the bacteria loses a part of cell wall or completely its cell wall, which we call them as L forms. So cell wall deficient L forms, or we also call them as protoplasts or spiroplasts, they may not initiate disease, but may be important in bacterial persistence during antibiotic therapy. So because they don't lack, they lack cell wall, all the antibiotics that act on the cell wall don't act on this. And finally, that results in the progression of the disease. Next, coming to the last topic, that is non-specific urethritis. So what do you understand by urethritis? So urethritis is nothing but the inflammation of the urethra. So most of the episodes are caused by infection that are caused by pathogen that enter the urethra from skin or the urethral opening. It may not be only due to the infection, that is by microorganisms. Sometimes even the mechanical injuries that occur during catheterization also results in urethritis. So what are the commensal flora of urethra? What are the normal flora that are usually present in your urethra? Are enterobacteriaceae members are the normal flora of urethra. We have alpha and gamma group streptococci. We have Enterococcus species, diphtheroids, and coagulase negative staphylococci. So these are all the common commensal flora of urethra. So how is urethra it is produced? So we have two, that is gonococcal and non-gonococcal. So gonococcal, we call it as gonococcal urethritis, and non-specific urethritis is also known as non-gonococcal. Apart from gonococcal, that is Neisseria gonorrhoeae, all other organisms which results in urethritis, we call them as non-gonococcal urethritis or non-specific urethritis. So what are all the factors that are responsible for causing your non-specific urethritis are? We have bacteria, viruses, fungi, protozoans. As I told you earlier, even mechanical or chemical injury can produce urethritis. So in non-gonococcal urethritis, the causative agents. For bacteria, yesterday we have learned about Chlamydia trachomatis. Today we have learned about Ureaplasma urolyticum and Mycoplasma pulmonis. So Gardnerella vaginalis, Acinetobacter species, are also responsible for causing non-gonococcal urethritis, which are the bacteria responsible for causing of NSU or non-specific urethritis. The viruses that are involved for NSU are herpes virus and cytomegaloviruses. Next, fungi, Candida albicans is responsible. For protozoans, that is Trachomon as vaginalis, that is Trichomonas vaginalis. Sorry, the spelling is wrong there. It is Trichomonas vaginalis is responsible for non-gonococcal urethritis. Mechanical or chemical irritation also results in NSU. So remember this table, all the bacteria responsible, Chlamydia trachomatis, Ureaplasma, Mycoplasma, Gardnerella, Acinetobacter species, viruses, herpes virus, cytomegalovirus. Fungi, we have Candida albicans, protozoan, that is Trichomonas vaginalis. So what are all the predisposing risk factors is? Sexual contact in which exchange of body fluids may occur. This may be a report that is due to multiple sexual partners. And other non-sexually transmitted infections, that is secondary to catheterization, as I told you, or instrumentation of the urethra, or association with other factors that contribute to urinary tract infections are the predisposing factors of NSU. So what are the clinical features? The incubation period of this disease is around 7 to 21 days. That is variable dysuria, that is urethral discharge or urethral itching. The discharge that is produced is usually mucoid, watery or white. So 10% of your non-gonococcal urethritis are usually asymptomatic. So diagnosis is, how do you go for a differential diagnosis of non-gonococcal urethritis is, If the laboratory is failed in demonstrating gonococci in gram stain or else in cultures, we have a doubt that it is non-specific urethritis. And yesterday I also told you that for urethritis, that is more than 4 polymorphonymphocytes per oil immersion field in urethral smear or in the first voided urine sample is also a suggestive of this urethritis. And finally, immunofluorescence. So treatment we give is doxycycline 100 mg BD, azithromycin 1 gram once daily, ofloxacin that is 400 mg BD for 7 days. Whenever possible, sexual partners should also be treated simultaneously. So this is about the whole story of your non-gonococcal urethritis. So non-gonococcal urethritis, when it is coming as a short notes, what you have learned now is enough. But once, if it is coming as an essay, so what you will try to write is, and Chlamydia trachomatis laboratory diagnosis is separate, Ureaplasma it's separate, Mycoplasma it's separate. So laboratory diagnosis, you'll just summarize it and then try to write it down as an essay question. So this is about your Chlamydia trachomatis. Any questions, you can ask me or you can contact me directly. Because you have my number. Yes?